So good morning to everyone. So today we are going to discuss about the chapter 7, body fluid and circulation. Under the body fluid and circulation, we are going to discuss about the subtopic today, body fluid. Under body fluid, we are going to discuss what are the different types of body fluids, and then followed by composition of blood that includes whatever the liquid part and the cell solid part. Then ABO blood grouping, RH typing, and then we are going to discuss about coagulation of blood as well as the composition and functions of lymph. Okay, first we'll move on to the body fluids and circulation. So under body fluid and circulation, when it comes to the introductory part, most of the animals, especially large animals like mammals, they are very active, and in order to prepare their foods, they have to go for locomotion. So they have to move from one place to another place, and for that they require more amount of energy, because more amount of energy is needed for the transport or locomotion of the higher animals. So when that case is, if it is a case, then where are they able to get this energy? Only from the food, like nutrients and all those things. Apart from this, the nervous systems, which is usually coordinating various activities, okay, by sending nerve impulses, that also requires energy. Okay, so all the higher organisms, for their coordinating activities inside the cell, they require energy. Okay, all living cells have been supplied with the nutrient, oxygen and other substances. So all the living cells are supplied with the nutrients, oxygen and other substances, and in turn the byproduct of breakdown of these nutrients will result in the formation of carbon dioxide and other waste products. Okay, so in your cell, some amount of nutrient, oxygen and substances are being transported, and some amount of waste material and carbon dioxide are being released from the cell. So it is very, very essential to have an efficient mechanisms for the transport of these substances. Okay, that is from the atmosphere to the cell, as well as from the cell to the atmosphere. So there should be an efficient mechanisms for the transport of the substances to and from the cells. Okay, so what is the efficient transport mechanisms that are present in different organisms? If we take different animals are having different method of transport. Okay, different animals are having different method of transports. But if we take smaller organisms like sponges and cnidarians, they don't have a separate circulatory system. So what is happening here? Water is mainly entering inside their body cavity by means of diffusion, and this water will try to facilitate the exchange of the substances. Because in smaller organisms, they don't have any separate circulatory systems. So only by means of water, the substances are being circulated, and only with the process called a diffusion. So the process involved is diffusion, and the fluid that is involved is water. Only with the help of this, they are able to exchange the substances within the cell, because they don't have any separate transport system. Whereas in case of more complex organisms like mammals and other organisms, you have a specialized fluid as well as a well organized transport system. So specialized fluids also there, and well-organized transport systems are there in higher animals. They generally used to perform the transport process transport process between the cells as well as within the cells. So mainly the transport process or the transport system, which usually transport these materials by means of bulk flow. So the transport system transport the material by bulk flow or connective transport with the pumps. What is meant by bulk flow? The bulk flow means what? It is a bulk means overall flow. Okay, it's not like a small amount is being transported. Bulk level of the materials are being transported one at a time. So only we call this name as bulk flow. Okay, so the phenomenon of the bulk flow is a fundamental to the many physiological process. Okay, so this bulk flow is a fundamental for various physiological process like digestion, respiration, excretions. So when you take carbon dioxide, when you take oxygen, and when you release carbon dioxide, the oxygen is moved in a bulk flow manner. Carbon dioxide is released in a bulk flow manner. Similarly, the food which is taken inside your through your mouth, no, it is also being in a bulk flow manner only. Okay, it is not moving from once the oxygen is not moving from your nose to the lungs by simple diffusion. It is just moving in a bulk flow. So all the fundamental process, all the physiological process, especially respirations, excretion and digestion, they are all usually able to undergo only this bulk flow process. So the bulk flow, what is the difference between the diffusion and the bulk flow? Bulk flow can transport the substances to a very long distance in a very faster rate than the diffusion. So when you just want to transport the materials, like small organisms are able to transport materials by diffusion, but if you are able to imply the same mechanism in higher organisms, it will not able to transport these materials to a very long distances. So substances or materials cannot be transported to very long distances. That means it will take many years to transport. So in order to overcome these drawbacks, complex organisms are having separate transport systems. They are able to transport the substances by means of a bulk flow. As a result, the substances are transported to a very far distances, that too within a short duration of time. So that is the main advantage of your bulk flow method. Okay, human circulatory systems, when you come to this, the human circulatory systems, it can circulate a milliliter of blood from heart to feet, again from the feet to the heart within 60 seconds. Or within 1 minute, a blood from the heart, it will be flowed into the feet, and again the same blood from the feet will be transported back into the heart within 1 minute. So in that way, your bulk flow systems are able to transport the substances in a very faster rate as well as for a very long distance. So diffusion is not the applicable method for the transport of substances in complex higher organisms. Okay, within our body, the oxygen and carbon dioxide are exchanged in the lungs and the tissues. Okay, so in the between the lungs and the tissues, carbon dioxide and oxygen are exchanged, whereas nutrients from the digestive systems are carried to the liver, and the waste from the tissues are carried by the blood and finally removed by the kidney. What they're trying to say here is that, so nutrients are exchanged between the lungs and the tissues, and in the case of the digestive systems, the digested foods are been carried by the blood and it is transported to the liver, and finally the waste materials produced in the cells are been transported by the same blood to the kidney and it is been removed. So blood is playing a major important role as a special fluid for the transport of substances. Okay, similarly the hormones are also been transported. So if you look at the mechanism of the blood, so mainly you see here, blood is able to transport or exchange the gaseous exchanges between the lungs. That is one point. Next, it is transporting the digested food from the intestine to the liver. That is the second function that is done by the blood. So blood is a second function that is done by your blood. Third important function is what? Blood is also able to remove the waste products that is produced from the cells through blood, and finally it is reaching the kidney, and kidney is finally removing all the waste materials. So that is the removal of waste material from by the kidney is usually favored by your transport mechanisms, especially blood. And not only this alone, the hormones are produced by various glands, you know. These hormones are being transported from the site of production to the target area or target organs only through blood. Okay, then finally the circulatory systems, no, because mainly the circulatory systems are able to perform all this transport process. So these circulatory systems also maintains a homeostasis. What is meant by homeostasis? It is a maintaining the steady state of your internal body environment. Maintaining steady state of internal body environment is called as a homeostasis. So these circulatory systems, it usually maintain the homeostasis of your body, homeostasis of your body fluid as well as your body temperature. So in your body you have 5 liters of body fluid. So the amount of this body fluid as well as the body temperature, 37 degrees centigrade, they are all being exactly maintained by these circulatory systems. So if you look at this diagram, you can see what are the ways by which our circulatory systems are able to I think they are not given here. Okay, no problem. So mainly these are the main important functions that has been performed by your circulatory systems. So a separate system is called a circulatory system is there, and these circulatory systems usually perform all these functions or perform the transport of all these gaseous nutrients, remove the waste products, transport hormones, maintain the homeostasis. That's the main role performed by our circulatory systems, especially the blood is usually doing all this process. Next, so sometimes the homeostatic regulation of the cardiovascular systems usually maintains, okay, the blood flow, okay, from the heart and the brain. There is a condition called, disease condition called as a vasovagal syncope, that is called as a fainting. So this condition will occur when the signal from the nervous systems, okay, when the signal from the nervous systems cause a sudden decrease in blood pressure. Signals from the nervous system cause a sudden decrease in blood pressure. As a result, the individual becomes faint and from the lack of oxygen to the brain. Since the signal is being coming from the nervous system, it causes a sudden decrease in the blood pressure, and it makes the organs, it makes the individuals to become faint because there won't be any supply of oxygen to the brain. So we call this condition as vasovagal syncope, that is fainting. Okay, so in this chapter what you are going to discuss is about what are the body fluids and what is meant by ABO blood group systems, and apart from this, what are the structure of your heart and what is the functions of your heart, what are the disorders of your hearts, all these things we are going to discuss. First we will start with your body fluid. So the body fluid usually consists of water and dissolved substances, water and dissolved substances present in them, so that is called as a body fluid. Okay, so water, in that some substances are dissolved in that, so we call this as a body fluid. Okay, there are two types of body fluids are there. One is called as intracellular body fluid, another is called as a extracellular body fluid. So what is known, intra means inside, so the fluid that is present inside the cell is called as a intracellular body fluid. Then extracellular body fluid, the fluid that is present outside the cell is called as extracellular body fluid. So there are three types of extracellular body fluids are there. Okay, so they are interstitial fluids, it is otherwise called as a tissue fluid. So this fluid usually surrounds the cell. Next is a plasma fluid, that is a fluid component of blood. So this is a fluid that is present in the blood itself. And the third part is a lymph, it is also surrounding the tissue fluids. Okay, so there are three important types of body fluids. One is called as interstitial or tissue fluids, plasma and a lymph. The blood flowing into the capillary from an arteriole has a high hydrostatic pressure. So now they are going to explain how the interstitial fluids are usually been formed in between the cells. Okay, so normally if you look at this diagram, you'll be understanding how the tissue fluids are usually been formed. Okay, so for example, this is a tissue. So in between, this is also a tissue. So in between this tissue, you'll be having a space, and in this space, we are having a fluid, and it is called as a tissue fluid. Okay. So how these tissue fluids are usually been formed? For example, this is the blood vessels that is passing very close to your tissue fluid, which is passing very close to your tissues. So this end is called as a arterial end. This end is called as a arterial end or capillary end. This is called as a capillary end. Okay, this end is called as a venous end. Okay, this is called as a venous end. Is it? So when a blood is able to pass through the capillary end, so it will be the inside the blood, you will be having a very high amount of hydrostatic pressure. You will be having a very high amount of inside. You will be having an increasing amount of hydrostatic pressure. So there will be a high amount of hydrostatic pressure will be present inside your body fluid, whereas the another one important pressure that is present in this tissue fluid is your osmotic pressure. So the osmotic pressure which is present in the tissue fluid will be very, very less. Okay, so two important pressure, one is called as hydrostatic pressure, and there will be another important pressure called osmotic pressure. So when a capillaries are able to move through the tissues, the capillary end usually normally will be having a very high amount of hydrostatic pressure. Okay, what is meant by hydrostatic pressure? It is a pressure that is formed because of more amount of water. Okay, hydro means water. So because of more amount of water, a pressure is formed at the capillary end. So you will be having a very hydrostatic pressure, increasing amount of hydrostatic pressure at the capillary end. At the same time, when you look at these tissue fluids, you will be having a very decreasing of osmotic pressure. This osmotic pressure is mainly because of the presence of plasma proteins. Okay, osmotic pressure is a function of plasma proteins. So capillary end will be having higher osmotic pressure and a decrease in the osmotic pressure. As a result, there will be a movement of the body fluid or the movement of the fluid from the blood into the tissues usually will take place. So the fluid will move from the blood into the tissue fluid. So fluid will move from the capillary end into the space that is present between the tissues. Okay. So after that, there will be a drop in the hydrostatic pressure so that the pressure will be reduced and it will be moving to this venous end. When there is a drop in the hydrostatic pressure, so when you come to the venous end, you will be having a decrease in the hydrostatic pressure, and then actually at the same time you will be having more amount of osmotic pressure. Okay, so you will be having a decrease in the hydrostatic pressure, but here you will be having more amount of increase in the hydrostatic pressure in the tissue fluid. When you look at this osmotic pressure, since more fluid has been lost from this capillary end and it is able to move, when the blood is able to move to the venous end, so you will be having more amount of plasma proteins here. Since more amount of plasma protein is here, you will be having an increase in the osmotic pressure, increase in the osmotic pressure in case of your venous end. So here there will be a decrease in the osmotic pressure. Okay, in the venous end there will be a decrease in the osmotic pressure. Since there is an increase in the osmotic pressure and here is a decrease in the osmotic pressure, so water will be moving from the tissue fluid into the venous end usually will takes place. Okay, so in case of your capillary end, higher hydrostatic pressure will be present inside the blood vessel, lower osmotic pressure will be present in the interstitial fluid. So water will be moving from the blood vessels into the tissue fluid will usually takes place. When you come to this venous end, since the more tissues have been lost in the capillary end and it is moving towards your venous end, the more amount of plasma protein will be there in this particular blood vessels. So presence of this plasma proteins will be having increasing osmotic pressure and decreasing the hydrostatic pressure. So then the condition in the tissue fluid will be just opposite to that of this one. So you will be having an increasing hydrostatic pressure, that means you will be having more amount of water, and you will be having a decreasing amount of osmotic pressure. As a result, the water from the tissue fluid will be moving towards the venous end of your blood vessels. So in this way, the tissue fluids are usually been formed. Okay, how the tissue fluid is formed? Only because of the difference in the two pressures. One is the hydrostatic pressure, another one is the difference in the osmotic pressure. Okay, so that's what they have discussed here. In your the volume of fluid that is leaked from the capillary to form a tissue fluid is a result of two pressures. One is hydrostatic and another one is called as a osmotic pressure. Okay, it is otherwise called as a oncotic pressures. Okay, so the mechanism what you have discussed here is same is being explained here in your slide. So next we'll move on to that's all about your body fluids. So another important body fluid is three important body fluids. Among that, one we have discussed, that is the interstitial body fluids you have discussed. Next, the lymph as well as the plasma body fluids we will discuss one by one. So next is the composition of blood. When you come to the composition of blood, the blood is the most common body fluid. So example for body fluid is a blood. Blood is the most important body fluid in higher organisms that helps for the transport of substances from one part of the body to the another part of the body. So sometimes they will call this blood not only as a body fluid, they also call blood as a connective tissue. because it connects the various, it is able to connect the various organs by moving from one part of your body to another part of the body, and it transport various substances from one part of the body to the other part of the body. So it is connecting, no? So only it is called as a connective tissue. So here when you have a connective tissue, you'll be having a matrix, and in that the substances will be distributed. That is called connective tissue. But here the matrix present in the blood is mainly the plasma. So the matrix present in the blood is a fluid matrix, and in that the formed elements like all other cells like blood cells, everything else will be scattered in this particular fluid matrix. So only we call this blood as a connective tissue. It is having fluid matrix plus formed elements. Okay, so in this the plasma part constitute only about 55%. When you take 100% of your blood, out of that plasma constitute about 55%, and the remaining 45% of your blood is mainly consisting of these formed elements. Okay, mainly the blood cells. So an average adult, which is usually who is mainly weighing about 70 kg, you should be having average blood of about 5000 ml or 5 liters. Each and every individual who is about 70 kg in weight usually carries 5000 ml or 5 liters of blood. Okay, that is the main content of your blood or body fluid present in an individual. Okay, so now you know that blood, body fluid, especially blood, is an example for body fluid, and it is consisting of two parts. One is plasma part, another one is the formed element part. First, we will discuss about the plasma part, which is about 55% of your blood. Okay. So when you come to this plasma, the plasma mainly consisting of water. The plasma mainly consists of 80 to 92% of water. That is mainly water. In which the plasma proteins, inorganic constituents, organic constituents, respiratory gases are dissolved. So mainly 92% of your plasma is mainly made up of water. In that, all the components like proteins, plasma protein, organic constituent, inorganic constituent, and respiratory gases are all been dissolved in that plasma. Okay, there are four main types of plasma proteins are being synthesized in the liver. Okay, what are the four main types of plasma protein? Now we are going to discuss about what are the different types of plasma proteins, what are all the organic component, what is the inorganic component, and what are the gases that is dissolved. Everything we are going to discuss. So when you come to this plasma proteins, there are four main types of plasma protein. They are albumin, globulin, prothrombin, and fibrinogen. These are the four important proteins that is synthesized in the liver, and it is being lodged in the plasma. Okay, so what is the functions of this albumin? It maintains the osmotic pressure of the blood. As we already discussed in the formation of interstitial fluid, the presence of the proteins mainly maintains the osmotic pressure. Okay, so it maintains the osmotic pressure of the blood. Okay, globulin usually mainly facilitates the transport of ions, hormones, and lipids, and it is also helped for immune function. So mainly globulin means, you know, that antibodies. The antibodies are beta globulin in nature. So the formation of antibody and protection of your body against the various infections are usually carried out by these globulin proteins. So these are also important protein, and this helps for transport of hormones, lipids, and ions, apart from producing immunity to various infections. Okay, so both prothrombin and fibrinogen. So apart from this, the another two proteins, prothrombin and fibrinogen, they are mainly involved in the clotting of your blood. Okay. So they are mainly involved in the clotting of your blood. The organic constituents mainly includes urea, amino acid, glucose, fat, and vitamins. So they are the organic constituents of your plasma. Okay. When you come to the inorganic constituents of your plasma, it includes chlorides, carbonates, phosphates of potassium, sodium, calcium, and magnesium. So you'll be having calcium phosphate, magnesium phosphate, sodium phosphate, and potassium phosphate. So all these are the inorganic constituents that is present in the plasma. Okay, the composition of the plasma will not be same. It will be keep on changing depending upon the situations. For example, immediately after your meal, what will happen is the blood in the hepatic portal vein. Hepatic means liver. Okay, so the blood in the hepatic portal vein will be having a very high concentration of glucose. So here now they are trying to say that the plasma concentration is not same. Because once you take a meal, after the meal, the liver's portal vein, no, you will be having a very high amount of high concentration of glucose, because the glucose has been transmitted from the intestine to the liver through this hepatic portal vein. So immediately after your meal, the blood vessel that is coming from the intestine to the liver will be having high amount of glucose. So that means the plasma composition is not same, it is keep changing depending upon the situations, and slowly this concentration of glucose gradually will be falling after some time once the glucose has been absorbed. Okay, so excess of glucose, when you are able to take more amount of glucose, okay, and if it is not been properly utilized, then what will happen? The excess glucose is stored as glycogen in the liver and in the muscles. So when you want to convert that excess glucose into glycogen, these glucose will move from the intestine to the liver by means of this portal vein. As a result, that there will be high amount of glucose in that particular portal vein. But the condition is not the same with respect to the breakdown of amino acids. So when you take more amount of proteins, it results in the formation of amino acids. But these amino acids cannot be stored like how the excess carbohydrates are stored. Okay, so when excess glucose is there, it is being stored as glycogen, but the excess amino acids, they are not being stored. Okay, that is the important thing you should know. And these amino acids are usually breakdowns and produce urea. Okay, so these high concentration of urea will be normally present in blood, especially in the hepatic vein, will be having a high concentration of urea than the blood usually present in the hepatic portal and the hepatic artery. Why there is a hepatic vein is having more amount of urea? Because it is a site where more amount of the digested amino acids will be reaching there. So it will be having a very high amount of conversion of this amino acid into urea. So there will be having a high concentration of urea in the hepatic vein, or the vein that is reaching the liver, than the vein that is present in the arteries and the hepatic portal vein. So this is the about our different types of organic and inorganic constituents that is present in the blood. So liver usually receives its blood supply from two important capillary, or by means of two important sources. One is hepatic artery that brings the oxygenated blood from the heart. Another one is the hepatic portal vein that usually been bringing the blood from the intestine into the brings the blood from intestine as well as from the other abdominal organs. Okay, so these are two important veins, the bloods or the arteries that through which the blood will be supplied. One is hepatic artery, another one is the hepatic portal vein, by which the blood will be able to reach the liver. Okay, next we are going to discuss about the formed elements. What are the formed elements that are being present in the your body fluid, that is in the blood? The formed elements mainly consist of red blood cells or erythrocytes, white blood cells or leukocytes, and platelets. Okay, so all these three constitute to form the formed elements. Okay, RBC, WBC and platelets. Okay, first we'll discuss about the RBC. Okay, if you look at the structure of RBC, this is a cross section of your RBC, and it is a surface, this is the structure of RBC when you view from the top view. Okay, this is called as the RBC structures. Okay, red blood cells are abundant than the other blood cells. So when you come to the formed elements, out of these three, RBC is more abundant than the other blood cells. It usually accounts for about 5 million to 5.5 million of RBC will be usually present per cubic meter. Okay, so a healthy man usually have healthy man will be having about 5 to 5.5 million of RBC per cubic meter, whereas healthy woman will be having 4.5 to 5 millions of RBC usually will be present, cubic millimeter will be present in the woman. Okay, the RBCs are basically very small in diameter. It is about 7 micrometer, so they are very small in diameter, about 7 micrometer they will be. Okay, so I think we saw the structure of RBC in the, just now. So the red blood cells of are the red color of RBC, the RBC is basically red in color, and it is mainly due to the presence of the respiratory pigment called hemoglobin. Okay, the respiratory pigment hemoglobin is usually present in the RBC, and this, because of this respiratory pigment hemoglobin, the RBC is red in color. So this hemoglobin, which is present in the RBC, and the cytoplasm of RBC. They play a major important role for the transport of respiratory gases and as well as the exchange of the respiratory gases between the fluid as well as between the cell or between the lungs as well as the blood vessels. Okay, so it mainly facilitates the transport of respiratory gases and exchange of gases with the fluid outside the cell. So the shape of your RBC, if you look at it, is a biconcave in shape. The shape of our RBC is biconcave in a shape. Okay, so as a result of the structure, it carries the oxygen can be very easily diffuses quickly in and out of the cell. Okay, that is the main use of your shape of your RBC. So RBCs are mainly don't have any nucleus. They are biconcave in shape for the easy diffusion of oxygen. Okay, apart from this, the cytoplasm of this RBC, they don't have any nucleus, mitochondria, ribosomes and endoplasmic reticulum. So because of absence of all these nucleus and all the cellular organelles, that space of the cytoplasm is completely filled by your hemoglobin. So this clearly indicates that the transport of oxygen is a main important role that is to be performed by your RBC. Okay, the absence of these organelles accumulates more hemoglobins, thereby maximizing the oxygen carrying capacity of your cell. Okay, now the average lifespan, how many days the RBC will be alive in a healthy individual? About 120 days the RBC will be alive. After that, they will be destroyed in the spleen. Okay, spleen is called as a graveyard for your RBC. So the half life of RBC is only 120 days. You know that RBC usually having heme plus globulin, no? So the globulin proteins will be destroyed, but the heme protein will be again recycled by the bone marrow for reuse. So okay, that is the main use of your spleen. Spleen will only recycle this iron which is present in the hemoglobin. So an important hormone called as a erythropoietin. It is an important hormone that is secreted by the kidney, okay, in response to low oxygen. Okay, when you are having a very low oxygen content, kidney will immediately produce an hormone called as erythropoietin, and these erythropoietin will try to help in the differentiation of stem cells in the bone marrow to produce more amount of erythrocytes. Whenever the oxygen is very less, kidney will produce the erythropoietin hormone. These hormone will try to activate the bone marrow to produce more amount of red blood cells. Okay, RBC. So the formation of more amount of RBC is called as a erythropoiesis. So these more amount of RBC which is formed will again bind to the oxygen and will try to bring more amount of oxygen into the body. So by this mechanism, the deficiency of oxygen or the supply of oxygen or the scarcity of oxygen in the blood plasma will be overcome. Okay, so the ratio of red blood cell to blood plasma is expressed as hematocrit. Okay, that is called as a packed cell volume. So the ratio of red blood cell to blood plasma, okay, is expressed as a hematocrit. So this is a term you have to understand. Next, we'll move on to the white blood cells. So when you come to the white blood cells are called as a leukocytes. The red blood cells are called as erythrocytes, whereas the white blood cells are called as a leukocytes. They are colorless amoeboid and nucleated cells. So when you come to the white blood cells, RBC is a basically biconcave in shape, whereas here it is amoeboid in shape. RBC is anucleated. They don't have any nucleus, but they have a nucleus here. Okay, so but the RBC is having hemoglobin, but they don't have any hemoglobin and other pigments. So approximately 6000 to 8000 per cubic millimeter of WBC is usually seen in the blood. Okay, 6000 to 8000 per cubic millimeter of WBCs are seen in the healthy individual. Okay, so the different types of RBCs are usually shown here. So okay, so you can able to see the different types of RBCs are here. So basically the WBC is divided into two types, granulocytes and agranulocytes. What is meant by granulocytes? If you have a presence of granules in that particular cell, it is called as granulocytes. Okay, if you don't have granules, it is called as agranulocytes. If you see this one, you see the presence of small granules here. Okay, these granules are seen here. So granulocytes are classified into three types. They are called as eosinophils, they are called as neutrophils, eosinophils and basophils. But when you come to these monocytes and lymphocytes, they don't have any granules here. You don't have any granules here. So they are called as agranulocytes. This is the granulocytes. Okay. Neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils are example for granulocyte cells. So now we'll discuss about what is the role of neutrophils. If you come to these neutrophils, they have a polymorpho, they are called as a polymorphonuclear. They are also called as a heterophil or polymorphonuclear. What is the meaning for poly? Poly means many. So they have a many morphology of a nucleus. Okay. So here if you look at this one neutrophil, you have a one morphology, here is another morphology, here is another morphology. So you have a polymorphology of nucleus. So that is a characteristic species of neutrophils. And then you will be having 3 to 4 lobes. This is a 1, 2, 3. So the nucleus will be having polymorphology. So it will not have a single morphology. It will have different in structure. And the number of lobes in this nucleus is maybe 3 to 4 lobes will be present. And these neutrophils will constitute for about 60 to 65% of your total RBC. So if you take a total RBC, neutrophils will constitute to about 60 to 65% of your WBC. Okay. These neutrophils are phagocytic. And they mainly appear in various infections. You are able to get any infections, the cell which is usually present here, it is a neutrophils. Okay. Next to that is a eosinophils. The eosinophils usually have a bilobed nucleus. You see here, you will be having 2 lobes, no? So they are a 2 lobed nucleus and they are joined by a thin strand. You see a thin strand is there, it is usually joining these 2 lobes. So when compared to neutrophil, eosinophils are non-phagocytic and they are present only 2 to 3% of your total RBC. Okay. So eosinophils are usually present during some allergic reactions as well as in some parasitic infections. Okay. In all type of infections you may have neutrophils, but only certain parasitic infections and allergic reactions you will see the eosinophils. Eosinophils are non-phagocytic, neutrophils are phagocytic. Okay. When you come to the basophil, so this is the structure of your basophil. So the basophils are having a less number, they are present basically less in number. Okay, only 0.5 to 1% they are present of the total RBC. But they have a very large granules, but these large granules are somewhat present in compared to that of your neutrophils and eosinophils. But the number of large granules are very, very less. The cytoplasmic granules are larger but fewer, okay, fewer than eosinophils. So the nucleus is usually seen in the form of large size and constituted into several lobes. You see here the nucleus are very, very large. It is also constituted into many lobes like neutrophils. So here the nucleus is also multi-lobed. That is what they are trying to say. So neutrophils and basophils are having multi-lobed nucleus. Okay. Then this multi-lobed nucleus are joined by delicate threads. Okay. So what is the functions of your basophils? So now we have discussed basophils is a multi-lobed. Okay. What is the functions of basophils? They secrete many substances like heparin, serotonin and histamines. They are anti-inflammatory substances. So during inflammation, these particular basophil cells are being highly produced. Whenever any inflammation is there, basophil cells are produced. These basophil cells will produce the substances called as the inflammatory substances. They include heparin, serotonin and histamines. So during parasitic infections, you will be having eosinophils. During all type of infections, you will be having neutrophils. But during inflammatory reactions, you will be having basophils. Okay. So next we'll move on to the agranulocytes. So as the name indicates, they don't have granules in the cytoplasm. It is of two types. One is called as a lymphocytes and the monocytes. These agranulocytes are mainly differentiated from the granulocytes. They are differentiated into agranulocytes in the lymph node and in the spleen. Okay, whereas granulocytes are differentiated in the bone marrow. Okay, okay. If you look at this diagram, you can able to see monocytes, lymphocytes. So when you are able to have a nucleus that is completely occupying the entire cell and it will be having only less amount of cytoplasm, it is called as a lymphocytes. If you have two bilobed nucleus, then it is called as a monocytes. So when you come to these monocytes, when this particular cells are present in the blood, okay, it is called as monocyte. Same monocyte when it is able to reach the tissues, then it is called as a macrophages. So in that macrophages, if the macrophages are present in the liver, then it is called as a Kupffer cells. If the same macrophages are present in the central nervous system, it is called as a microglia. Okay, so the same macrophages are present in the pulmonary region, okay, then it is called as a alveolar macrophages. Okay, so basically these lymphocytes constitute for about 1 to 3% of your total RBC, and the nucleus in the lymphocyte is usually kidney shaped. You have a kidney shaped nucleus that is present here. Okay, so when you come to this lymphocytes, right? So the lymphocytes are usually consist of two important types. One is called as a B lymphocyte, another one is called as a T lymphocytes. Okay, you have two types of lymphocytes, T and B lymphocytes are present. Okay, so these lymphocytes are usually consist of 20 to 28%, whereas monocytes have only 1 to 3%, whereas lymphocytes are 28% are present. You have two types of lymphocytes. One is B lymphocyte, T lymphocyte. Both B and T are involved in the immune responses. B lymphocytes, okay, are in short form they say call it as a B cell. T lymphocytes in short form they call it as a T cell. So B cell will produce antibodies to neutralize the various harmful effects that is caused by a foreign substances. Okay, any foreign substances able to enter inside our cell, B cell will produce antibody, and this antibody will go and bind to the foreign substances. That is the role of your B cell. When you come to T cell, T cell will be involved in the cell mediated immunity. It is also protecting our body, but the mechanism is by means of cell mediated immunity. Okay, so that's all about your monocytes and your macrophages, monocytes and the lymphocytes. Okay, next we'll move on to the platelets. So platelets, usually if you look at these platelets, you will be having a platelets or other is called as a thrombocytes. Okay, so the platelets usually produced from megakaryocytes, especially from the special cells. Megakaryocytes are special cells seen in the bone marrow. So from this bone marrow, these especially the platelet cells are thrombocytes are produced. Okay, these platelets also lack nucleus like your RBC. When you come to the formed elements, WBC is only cell formed element that is having nucleus. Red blood cells and platelets, they don't have nucleus. Okay, blood normally contains about 150,000 to 350,000 platelets per cubic meter of your blood. Okay, they usually secrete substances that is involved in the coagulation or clotting of blood. Okay, mainly coagulation or clotting of blood usually takes place by means of your thrombocytes. Okay, how the clotting is usually taking place, we will see in the next video. So the reduction in the platelet number may lead to the clotting disorders. If you are able to have any reduction in the RLS, that is a very low number of your platelets, it usually results in the clotting of your, it results in the clotting disorders. As a result, you may be able to have a more amount of loss of blood from the site where you get wounded. So the presence of this platelet number is to be very, very important. So, when you come to these platelets, no, you know that they are playing a major important role for clotting of blood. Now we will see how the clotting or coagulation of blood usually takes place. For example, if you have any cut in your finger, okay, so you may be get bleeding from your particular cut here. Okay, you may have a mainly you will be having a bleeding of blood from the cut here. Okay, after 3 or 2 or 4 or 5 minutes, immediately the cut end will be get clotted normally in a healthy individual. Okay, so this clotting or coagulation of blood usually takes place in a cut end after 4 or 5 minutes, and the bleeding of blood will be stopped. How this bleeding of blood is usually stopped? Mainly because of the coagulation or clotting of blood. So cut end where the bleeding is usually stopped after 5 minutes is mainly due to the clotting of blood, or because of the coagulation of blood the bleeding stops. So okay, so now they call this term as a blood coagulation or clotting. The mechanism, there is a mechanism that is involved, okay, there is a mechanism is been separately involved in clotting the blood. Okay, so the mechanism by which the excessive blood loss is prevented, the excessive blood loss is prevented from the area where you have been get wounded, no? Okay, is called as a blood coagulation or clotting of blood. Okay, the mechanism by which excessive blood loss is prevented by formation of a clot. So how the blood loss is prevented? By a formation of a clot. So a mechanism by which the loss of blood is prevented by formation of a blood clot is called as the clotting of blood or coagulation of blood. Okay, so normally this diagram clearly indicates how the blood is usually being get clotted. Okay, first you will see that if you have any tissue or anything else get damaged, when you're able to have any damage in your tissues, okay, clotting usually first process is the clotting usually begins when your endothelium of your blood vessel get damaged. When your endothelium of your blood vessels get damaged, what will happen immediately? The connective tissue in that particular endothelium will be get exposed. As a result, these platelets will be activated, and these platelets are, we know that they are blood clotting, they are the blood clotting cells. These platelets will be able to adhere to the collagen fiber which is present in the connective tissue. So what they are trying to say is that at the damaged site, or the when a blood vessel is get damaged, okay, or the endothelium of your blood vessel get damaged, then immediately the platelets will be adhered to that particular area, and it will be able to produce the substances and it forms a platelet plug. Okay, so and this usually provides an emergency protection against the blood loss. So you can see from this diagram, when you are having any tissue damage, that is any blood, if you have any, what are the blood vessels get damaged, immediately this damaged tissue will stimulate the platelets to get adhere, and it forms adhering of platelets at the site of the wound where the blood is been get damaged. Okay, any blood vessel get damaged, it will induces the recruitment of platelets. So more platelets will be just reach the area where the blood vessels get damaged, and these platelets will adhere one among other, they will adhere together, and they form a plug, and it is called as a platelet plug. Okay, so formation of platelet plug will be taking place at the site where there is a tissue damage. So these platelet plug will induces the intrinsic clotting factor. So there are two types of clotting mechanisms. Here this formation of platelet plug, it induces or it activates the intrinsic clotting mechanisms. As a result, what will happen? The production of prothrombin activator substances. So the prothrombin activator in the intrinsic clotting factors, the prothrombin activator substances will be produced, and these prothrombin activator substances, it will activate the prothrombin. It will activate the inactive form of prothrombin into thrombin. So for that it requires calcium and another important ions. So the two important ions are been usually required for the activation of this prothrombin into thrombin, that is calcium and vitamin K is been mainly involved for the conversion of prothrombin into thrombin. Okay, this is usually taking place. So then this thrombin acts enzymatically on fibrinogen. So there is another important protein called as a fibrinogen. It is an inactive form of your clotting protein. Okay, these fibrinogen will be converted into fibrin. Okay, these fibrin, which is a small thread like structures, these many fibrins are combined together, and it forms a mesh like structure at the damaged site, and it traps the blood vessels, platelets, plasma proteins, and at the site of wound where you will be having a bleeding. Okay, and it just plug that particular area to prevent the, and it try to arrest the bleeding from that particular area. So there is a mechanism that is involved in your clotting of blood. So first is a formation of when you have a damaged end of blood vessel get damaged, immediately it is followed by formation of platelet plug. So these platelet plug will induces the intrinsic clotting factors, intrinsic clotting mechanism. It will induces the intrinsic clotting mechanism. These intrinsic clotting mechanisms is usually started with formation of many clotting factors. Many clotting factors will be formed in these intrinsic clotting mechanisms. These clotting factors will be activated one by one, and finally you will be able to form a substances, prothrombin activator substances. Prothrombin activator substances will activate the prothrombin into thrombin, The thrombin will convert fibrinogen into fibrin, and the fibrin is the small thread-like structures. They are able to adhere one among each other, and they form a mesh-like structure. In that mesh-like structures, blood cells, platelets, and other proteins will be get formed, and it just clog the area where the bleeding usually takes place, and it arrests the bleeding. So this is the mechanism that is involved in the clotting of your blood by blood platelets. Next, move on to the ABO blood grouping as well as the Rh typing. Okay, so when you come to this blood grouping, there are two common different types of blood groups are present. One is ABO and Rh blood groupings. So they have been generally widely used all over the world. So blood grouping commonly composed of two types. One is ABO and another one is Rh type. So when you come to this ABO blood grouping, based on the presence of these surface antigens and RBC, okay, the blood groups are classified into, you see here, based on the presence or absence of the surface antigen, the blood groups are classified into A, B, AB and O. Okay, so these surface antigens are otherwise called as agglutinogens. Okay, so if a blood group RBC is having a surface antigen A, then the particular blood group is A. Similarly, the surface antigen on the RBC surface, okay, the surface antigen on the membrane of RBC is B, okay, then the blood group will be B. Similarly, if a surface antigen you have both the surface antigen A and B on the surface of your RBC, you have both A and B antigen on the erythrocyte, okay, then the particular blood group is called as AB. If you don't have any surface antigen, okay, there won't be any antigens on the membrane of your RBC, then this RBC or the blood group is called as a O blood group. Okay, so the blood groups are classified into A, B, AB and O based on the presence or absence. If the AB and AB are present, okay, so if the presence of antigens are there, it may be able to form A or B or AB blood group. If there is no antigen on the RBC, it results in the formation of O blood group. Okay, now they use a term called as a isoantibody. They use a term called as a isoantibody or natural antibody, okay, or agglutinin. Okay, what is meant by agglutinin? Agglutinins are the antibodies, okay, that is being produced against antigen, that is being produced against the surface antigen A, or it is produced against the surface antigen B. Okay, so you have a surface antigen A and B. Towards the surface antigen A and B, if antibodies are produced, no, okay, then these specific antibodies produced against the surface antigen are called as agglutinin or isoantibody. It is otherwise called as an isoantibody. Okay, so when you look at this blood group, a blood group person A will have antigen A, but this isoantibody, they simply name it as anti-A, anti-B, something like that. Okay, if a blood group is A, he will be having a surface antigen or agglutinogen A, but he will be having the isoantigen or the agglutinin antibody anti-B. Is it clear? This anti-B is a agglutinin or antibody that is present in the plasma of an individual. For A group person, the agglutinin or the antibody that is present is anti-B. Okay, it is anti-B that is present in the plasma. Similarly, for a blood group B, the antigen present is B, but the antibody will be anti-A. For a blood group person AB, the antigen present will be AB, whereas the antibody will not be there. No antibody will not be there in case of AB blood group. So when you come to this O blood group, they will not have both A and B antigen, but they have both anti-A and anti-B on its surface. Okay, so in this way, the blood groups are classified into A, B and O. Okay, then we will move on to the Rh factor called the D antigen. The presence of Rh factor means what? It is a protein called D antigen. When a D antigen is present on the surface of red blood cells, when the D antigen are present on the surface of red blood cells, then it is called as a Rh factor. Okay, mainly If your presence of antigen is there, then the they are called as a Rh positive. If the D antigen are not present on the surface of RBC, then they call him as a Rh negative. Why they call this D antigen as Rh antigen? Because they found that this type of D antigen, similar antigen, is usually present in the rhesus monkey. So they just gave the name for this D antigen as Rh factor or Rh antigen. Okay, the presence of antigen is positive. The absence of antigen on the RBC surface of RBC, it is a Rh negative. Okay, so the Rh factor compatibility will be checked before transfusion. So when you are just going to transfer a blood from one individual to another individual, the Rh factor will be tested. Okay, before the transfusion. So Rh factor compatibility will be checked before the transfusion of the blood. Okay, when a pregnant woman is Rh negative and when she is able to marry a Rh positive father, the fetus will be Rh positive. Okay, so now what will happen? This pregnant woman, when she is able, during the time of pregnancy, the pregnant woman will not be get affected because of this Rh positive antigens which is present in the fetus. Okay, which is present in the surface of the RBC of your fetus. Okay, but at the time of delivery, there is a chance of mixing of blood from the fetus into the mother's blood. As a result, these Rh antigens from the fetus may enter the mother's may enter the mother's blood circulation through placenta. Okay. However, the small amount of fetal antigens becomes exposed to the mother's blood during the birth of a first child. That's what we have discussed. So the mother's blood starts synthesizing this D antibody or antibody against the D antigen. And when the same mother is able to undergo subsequent pregnancies, what will happen? These Rh antibody from the mother, it will enter the fetus circulation, because when the mother is able to undergo second pregnancy, again the child will be Rh positive. So as a result, what will happen? Already the RhD antibodies have been produced and it is having the memory of that particular antigen. So this mother immune system will produces Rh antibody. This antibody will reach the fetus mother, it will reach the fetus blood circulation, and it will just lyse the RBC of the fetus. As well, the fetus becomes suffer from anemia and jaundice. Since it lyse the RBC, the deficiency of RBC will takes place in the fetus, and we call these conditions as anemia, and it also leads to jaundice. So this, the conditions of anemia and jaundice collectively, that is taking place because of the lysis of RBC of the fetus, because of the reaction of the antibody from the mother, no? So we call this entire process as erythroblastosis fetalitis. Okay, this condition, erythroblastosis fetalitis, will occur only when a mother is Rh negative and the child is Rh positive, and during the time the first child will be not being get affected, and the same mother is able to conceive for the second child, that time the second child will be affected, and her RBC or his RBC will be destroyed by antibody produced from the mother. So this RBC destroyed, and it results in a condition called anemia and jaundice, and we call this collectively all these disease condition as erythroblastosis fetalitis. So how can we avoid this erythroblastosis fetalitis? Immediately after the first delivery, you have to administer the anti-D antibody. Okay, you have to administer the anti-D antibody or ROCAM antibody immediately after the first childbirth. You have to give this antibody to the mother. As a result, the antigen which is entering from the first the antigen that is entering from the first fetus, no, into the mother circulations will not be taking place. It will be neutralized, and as a result, the mother will not be get sensitized. So when she is able to conceive for the second child, she will not be able to get the second child will not be get affected, and it can be escaped from this erythroblastosis fetalitis disease. So that's all about your Rh factor and the ABO blood grouping. Next slide. Thank you.